next we look at a couple of example problems that exist in distributed computing for which algorithms have been developed. So you find a longer list in the literature here, but here is a short listing with a short explanation from me. First of all, in a distributed system, you may want to broadcast some information. That means one server or client wants to broadcast an information like my age is 35 across everyone, like everyone in the world. A second problem is atomic commit. So you want to make a set of changes, but you want to make sure that this set of changes looks like one operation. So like I want to reduce your bank account by £5 and give £5 to your friend, for example. So it's money transfer. What you don't want to have is that your bank account gets reduced by £5 and then, well, the system crashes and the £5 basically vanish in nirvana. So the atomic commit ensures that you can bundle operations together. It's a bit like these transactions that we talked about, and have them look like a single operation. So either all happen or none. Then we have consensus, which means the distributed system agrees on a common decision. Well, that obviously is a problem if there are different opinions about the data and you want to make sure that everyone has the same, you know, sees the same data. So leader election, to choose a single process that leads a distributed system some operations. We have mutual exclusion, that means have a distributed critical section where only one of the distributed processes can enter at a time, do some operations. This is very much related to our atomic commit. We have non-blocking data structures as algorithms that they are actually really awesome. So these data structures allow you to concurrently modify and access data. Think about like of a list that you have of information, and everyone can at any time remove or append data to this list. And you can do this without locking the data structure. Yeah? And if you have programmed lists in the C and C++ module, you would know that this is actually really hard to do. Okay, replication, that means you want to make sure that some data that exists or information exists is replicated in a consistent way so that the same data, everyone has the same data at the end. Then you want to do some resource allocation, it means to provide or allocate resources to different tasks and user. And lastly, there is a spanning tree generation, that means you want to make sure that there is one way, effective way to communicate between all the peers some information without cycles. So let's look a little bit more at the typical problem of consensus. So in this problem, several processes must agree or decide for a single data value. Okay, the single data value could be my age, it could be my name, it could be something that is more complicated and bigger. What we assume is that any process, so it could be an external process, may propose a value at any time. Okay, so we get different inputs. You know, the value should be 5, the value should be 7, no, the value should be 10, right? But at the end, you want to decide about a common value. And this problem is really related to a consistency problem. And there exists protocols such as Paxos that ensure cluster-wide consistency. And they are very sophisticated. So they tolerate typical errors in distributed systems like network outages, CPU mistakes, hardware faults, and race conditions. So a race condition means one process is faster than the other. So in this context of consensus algorithms, you find also the term Byzantine protocols. And these protocols, they allow you to tolerate lying processes. So what happens if someone maliciously try to inject some kind of value which isn't true? Right? Instead of saying my age is 35, they would say 10 or 120, I don't know. So how can we deal with that? bytes and TIN protocols can tolerate a couple of processes that have wrong information. Okay, when we achieve consensus, there are certain properties involved. First of all, every correct process must agree on the same value. Okay? Secondly, integrity. All correct processes decide upon at most one value v. Okay? And if v has been decided to be, then someone has proposed that the value must be v. Okay, it's a bit like in our problem with when I tell you I'm 35 or I'm 36 or 38, what have you, right? You can't just say I'm 37 if this data has never been proposed. And you can't say my value is 35 and 36. So you have to make a decision for one value and this value has ever been proposed. So it must be valid. So if all processes propose the same value v, then the correct processes must decide that v is the correct value. So if everyone tells you I'm 35, which isn't true, right, then everyone must have this information and assume this is the correct information. So and lastly, it must terminate. So every process must decide to have a value and can't just reply unknown. So Paxos comes with a couple of assumptions that you can read for. First of all, the processors, they do not lie or attempt to subvert the protocol. They do, however, can operate at arbitrary speed, so someone can be faster or slower to make a decision. They can experience failures, and after they have experienced the failure, they can rejoin and still come to the same conclusion. Messages can be sent from one processor to any other processor, and they are delivered without corruption. Okay, so it means they don't change the value. However, they can be sent asynchronously. So that means you can start to send a couple of messages while you don't know that they have yet been received. And they may take arbitrarily long to deliver. They may be lost, reordered, or duplicated. So that is really fault tolerance, what we mean to deal with Paxos. When it is implemented and it achieves consensus with the properties that are mentioned here, it tolerates a couple of errors that is pretty much half of the processes. So you can say if you have two F plus one processors, then you can have F faults. Okay, so about half of the processors can fault and you still get the right answer. You can reconfigure the system and then you can tolerate more errors, but at any time only F processes can fault, and then the system will reconfigure and again work correctly. Okay, I mean the algorithms itself, they are rather complicated, and if you are interested, have a look at them. I just wanted to introduce the properties and how you can write down the requirements and basically the key properties that are offered in terms of fault tolerance that you can expect from such an algorithm, right? Good, then we have distributed transactions. The goal here is to have our atomic commitment of changes, like our transaction for databases. So you can think of, do you have a distributed database and a customer well wants to make an order. So you have a front-end system, the user puts in the order, then you start a transaction with your distributed database, which means part of the tables are placed on different hosts, or you have the key somehow distributed. So you may want to update a customer table, making a note that a certain order has been placed by this customer. You want to update the order table. Often what you also want to do is you want to internally update the item table to make sure that this item, you know, the number of available items is reduced by one. And then you commit the transaction. And the user gets finally the answer, yes, your order has been placed, or there was a problem placing the order, please retry. So the goal is really to make a safe commit of this whole transaction using our AC transactions semantics that we know from databases. So either everything happens or none. And again, you can look up how this algorithm works. I think this one is a bit easier to understand than Paxos. Lastly, I want to show a little example for microservices. So what we could think of, we have splitted our tables into a microservice that manages the customer and one that manages the orders. You can think of, you have this front end where the order is placed. What you need to do is you have to update the customer microservice with information about the available funds, for example. Then you want to create the order in this order microservice. And you could think of that then the next step would be you want to update the customer microservice again, adding information about the order in the customer such that they can see the list of orders they have done, for instance. And then the order has been placed. Okay, so we decouple, you know, this coarse-grained operation that we have here as a database operation into microservices that take care for individual tables. Oh, I actually added and give an overview of the two-phase commit protocol because it's so much easier. So a two-phase commit, 2PC, sometimes it's called. So an idea that has been used for it is that one process coordinates the commit and checks that all agree on the decision made. So how does it work? You have a preparation phase and then you have a commit phase. So this is basically two phases, right? Why this is called two-phase commit protocol. In the prepare phase, you have already elected this coordinator that sends a message with the transaction to all participants. Then the participants execute the transaction until a commit is needed. And then you would reply with that commit has been made, or there is a conflict because you have executed, for instance, another transaction at the same time that has changed the status. Okay, and you make some notes about the changes that you would do in a so-called undo or redo logs. So then the coordinator checks the decision by the replies, and if every process replies with yes or the commit is possible, then, well, you can decide that the commit works. Then you go to the commit phase. In the commit phase, the coordinator sends a message to all processes with the decision. Example, please commit. Then the processes can commit using their logs, basically, or roll back using the undo log, the transactions. And they send an acknowledgement to the coordinator. And then finally, the coordinator sends the reply to the requester. So what happens if one of the processes sees a conflict? Well, at this stage, the coordinator would see that he can't commit, would communicate this information, and everyone would roll back this transaction, and it would be like it has never happened. So what can happen is that not only one of the participants fails, but also the coordinator could fail. And, well, we can think about what a participant should do upon such a failure and how it could detect them. Think about it a little bit, and then we can discuss this as part of the exercises. So for our bank example that we discussed, well, we create a transaction or a TID, then we prepare the customer fund with this transaction ID, and also we give our microservice here the information that we want to update the order. Then we get the information prepared, which basically means now commit or not, right? And then we go to phase two, in which we inform both of them with the decision. We get an acknowledgement, and then we are pretty much done. Good. So the algorithm is consistent hashing. This is basically used as a data structure allowing you to distribute key value data in a distributed system. What kind of data could it be? Well, imagine the value of the data is some kind of file. Okay, so you have a file, 20 megabyte file, that you want to share with someone. So what is the key? Well, the key could be the file name or some kind of hash that allows you to share this information with your colleague. So consistent hashing allows you to perform load balancing. That means that all nodes have a similar number of keys. And this is a very important property, because if you don't distribute the workload evenly in a distributed system, you are basically bound by the server that has the most of the load. Right, so if I have 10 servers and I have 100 workload and one of the server get 90 of the workload items, well, the load is not well distributed, and so most of the requests will hit this single server. So that's a problem. So I have to somehow balance the load. Secondly, fault tolerance. We want to make sure that I can add new servers or nodes, and I can remove nodes because they may fail. So the idea now is that you distribute the keys and the servers on a ring that goes from 0 to m minus 1. So here we have an image of a ring. So basically you have the number 0, and then it goes up and up and up until m minus 1, which is the last item here, and then the ring warps over to item 0 again. So the items that you have, you will distribute on this ring. So let's assume I have here three items, Venus, Mars, and Saturn, that I somehow, this is my keys, right? Not talking about the data. Data can be arbitrarily big. And I want to somehow identify on which server they should live. In this example, I have three servers, three server nodes. This, the red server, the blue server, and the green server. Now what I can do is I basically hash. That's where the term consistent hashing comes in. I hash the IP addresses, which gives them a place on this ring. And as our items are strings, I also run a function that hashes these items, which also places them on the string. Now all that is needed is to find out who is responsible for a certain item, which server. And this is as simple as follows. So where do we place this item Venus, right? Assuming that the hash points to this location. So this is bigger than the red server over here, but smaller than the blue server. So in this case, we always assign an item to the server that has the next following up number in our ring. So Venus would be placed on the blue server. Mars, that is located here, would be located on this server that is hashed on this location. Okay, so that's the basic idea of hashing the items and hashing servers to the ring. So now there is a key idea to achieve fault tolerance. So what we do is that we store each item multiple times on this ring. Therefore, we can use, for example, multiple hash functions, or we use, you know, for a string, we append a prefix or suffix to it and use the same hash function. So that means Venus would be placed, for example, one time here, but it could also be placed here, for example, and here when we hash it three times. So in that case, we would find from each of these locations again the next responsible server. So we would be find that all those three servers would be responsible for the value, the key value of Venus. So another issue is that we want to achieve load balancing. Well, in this case, it appears that the blue server has this small range, the green server has this small range, but the red server has about twice as much data to hold. To make sure that the data is better distributed, what we can do is that we hash a server multiple times, for example, again, three times, on this ring. So, and we can apply again the same kind of algorithms that would remove the items to very small, much smaller ranges and distribute the load more evenly. Okay, so another question that we may have is what happens if we add nodes or servers, or if we add nodes and servers. So what we need to do is, well, if in this case the red server fails, all the items that would be placed in this area here of the ring, they are basically lost. They may come back later if the server connects to the network again, but they may be lost forever. So that to redistribute new items is rather easy, because if you have to add a new item in this area, for example, I would add Saturn, and I would try as a client to store it on the red server, but the red server is not connectable, well, I would assume it's basically dead. So I would send this item to the next responsible server, here the blue server, okay, which has the responsibility. So there are many aspects of consistent hashing that you can find out, and the video here describes them really nice. So please have a look at them. I find it a really nice algorithm and rather easy to understand and intuitive what the benefit about it is.